Hi everyone, this is Tony. This will be a brief introduction before the video begins. What I would like to express to everyone is that the reason why we the reason why I'm putting forth these videos is so that we can be informed about what our adversaries all know. And not only that, but also by the true forms of the adversary, so that we can not be caught unaware and not be ignorant of their devices. So moving on, I don't want to make this go on too long. The video that I have is from the Fuel Project. Actually, there's two videos, one on Lilith and one on Bohemian Grove, and they are connected. And I recommend that you all go to thefuelproject.org. That's the website of the people who put this together, and I believe their research is very good research. And so what really surprised me was that they seem to understand that the spirit behind Bohemian Grove is tied to Mother Nature, and not a lot of people put that together, but the owls and Mother Nature are intertwined. They are inseparable. And so, and also another thing that they understood is that the cremation of care is related to the shedding of moral, what's typically accepted as moral, or what is accepted as the ordinary, you know, with what we all accept as good. And so it embraces, I have a picture here of the Baphomet, and we see on the left hand side, the left hand side adopts the breaking of taboos and the abandoning of set morality. At its roots, the left hand path is the feminine path, and you can find that information on both Wikipedia and on the sect of the horned god.com. I recommend that you watch my video on Black Lives Matter, or it's called invoking the Dark Mother, Black Lives Matter. That's the title of the video. And also the Owls in Bohemian Grove Revisited, that video also. So without further ado here, I'll play the two videos for you, and I hope that you find them helpful and edifying. So thank you for watching this video, and Jesus bless you.
If we zoom in on the capital again from the air, we see this shape which resembles an owl. Owls are significant because they represent wisdom. In Greece, the goddess of wisdom was called Athena, and she was associated with owls. Wise old owls are common in many other stories and in ancient mythologies. In virtually every Disney movie near a forest, there will be a wise owl to lend a hand. You often see them also wearing glasses and surrounded by books. The reason for this association is that owls are nocturnal creatures who can see in the dark. Being able to see things no one else can see is a metaphor for the occultist. The owl combines the ideas of knowledge and enlightenment. The owl symbol also brings us to a character called Lilith. Now, the stories surrounding Lilith are so contradictory and confusing that it's virtually impossible to get to the root of it all, but in nearly all cultures she is thought of as a powerful female demon. The most commonly accepted myth about her from the Jewish Kabbalah is that she was the original wife of Adam in the Garden of Eden, predating Eve. The story goes that when they came to have sex, Lilith refused to lie underneath Adam in what she perceived to be a submissive position, and instead demanded to be on top. She wanted to be dominant over Adam. According to the Kabbalah, this fight led to Lilith flying away from the garden to a cave on the shores of the Red Sea. Within the cave, she accepted the demons of the world as her lovers and spawned thousands of demon children in a short period of time. She then became known as the Mother of Demons and the wife of a character called Asmodeus, who was considered to be the King of Demons. In this form, she is known as the younger Lilith. According to the Kabbalah, Adam then tried to make peace with her by asking God to send three angels to reason with her and bring her back. If she refused to return to the garden, the angels informed her that they would kill 100 of her demon children every day. Lilith still refused, and in her jealousy of Eve, Adam's new wife, she swore to exact a similar kind of punishment on her children. She would attack and kill the children of Adam and Eve. She also vowed to attack men in their sleep, not to kill them, but to rape them for semen, so she could give birth to more demon children. So therefore she became known as a succubus, a female demon who attacks people sexually at night. The whole idea of demons interacting with humans sexually in ancient times exists in the Bible also, when it talks about the Nephilim around the time of Noah. Some traditions depict Lilith as being part serpent, and some even depict her as being embodied in the serpent in the Garden of Eden, as though she was somehow present in that moment. In these traditions, she is represented as the wife of Satan, or Samael, and the suggestion there is that the temptation of Adam and Eve was a joint effort between the two. Lilith provided the body and Satan the voice. As the wife of Samael, rather than Asmodeus, she is known as the Elder Lilith. This may seem like a minor alleyway to be spending so much time on, but the word Lilith is actually mentioned once in the Bible, in Isaiah 34:14. Modern versions translate the name as things like night creatures or night monster, night animals, and in the Old King James Version it's translated as screech owl, hence the association with owls. Other versions say night owl or night bird, so esoterically owls represent this female demon. Lilith is also particularly important because Satanists revere her as the rising queen of our age, the most prominent demon of our times. Anton LaVey proclaimed in 1966 that that would be the year of the beginning of the Age of Satan, but that it could be more accurately described as the Age of Lilith. He thought her influence would grow immensely from that point and start to define our times. And her traits do indeed correspond closely to the social trends of the past two centuries, and in particular the past few decades. Up until the 1800s, Lilith was always seen as a dark, evil demon, but after that century, sympathetic, artistic portrayals began to emerge. She is now not thought of as an evil demon, but rather a noble goddess, and her traits are becoming revered and loved. For example, Lilith is something of a role model and figurehead for the feminist movement because of her independence and desire not to be submissive to men. She is also therefore the demon behind the natural conclusion of feminism, which is lesbianism. She may also be the force behind cross-dressing and transsexuality. Things associated with her today also include what the world would call sexual freedom, i.e. fornication. This definitely erupted in our culture in 1966 as contraception and technology changed the relationship between people and Lilith. Just the following year, in 1967, the so-called Summer of Love happened, where everyone basically went sex crazy. People feel they can now embrace Lilith and her lusts with no repercussions. However, she is also the demon behind murderous abortions and sexual diseases, which are the natural results of licentious living. These things are skyrocketing beyond control in our modern world. Lilith represents things which are beautiful and tempting on the outside, but which lead to destruction, the kind of woman that Proverbs warns against in the Bible. Finally, Lilith is also associated with the modern, glamorized image of vampires, which has become incredibly popular of late. Several translations of the Bible use the term night monsters or night creatures for the word Lilith, and the 1922 Moffat translation of the Bible explicitly translates the words as vampires. Vampires, of course, are night creatures who attack people in their sleep, feeding off the lifeblood of those individuals. At the time of this video in 2011, this is one of the most noticeable manifestations of Lilith, as you can't help but notice the increasing glamorization of vampires with movies such as Twilight by Stephenie Meyer. Connected with vampires is also the idea of immortality without reference to God, which is also appealing to occultists. Many of Lilith's traits correspond exactly with Asherah, but traditionally she has always been considered to be a separate being. Therefore, how closely they are connected is hard to discern. I personally would suggest that their traits are so similar that they are in fact the same force. Further evidence to support this theory can be found when we consider that Lilith was identified by occultist Aleister Crowley and others under the name Babylon. Perhaps Lilith was the demon that controlled Semiramis and which then became known as Jezebel or Asherah. As Satan attempts to re-establish Babylon in the modern world, it is for these reasons that Lilith or Asherah is considered by his followers to be the most important rising goddess of our time. If you're not convinced that the image of the capital really represents an owl, however, and to be fair, some aren't, it's also worth mentioning a place called Bohemian Grove. The Bohemian Club was established in 1872 in San Francisco as an exclusive club for political and intellectual figures who wanted to spend some time each year relaxing and interacting in a non-business environment, in other words, a playground for the elite. They began camping at the present site of what's known today as Bohemian Grove, 2,437 acres of private redwood forest sealed off by security. Every midsummer, around 1,500 of the most powerful politicians and businessmen from within and from without the United States attend. Early sources suggest it was established specifically for people who would become part of what we now call the media, basically the people with the power to influence public opinion, artists, writers, movie makers, etc. The all-male membership contains a particularly high number of musicians. Their involvement helps explain the name Bohemian Grove. Every Republican president since 1923 and some Democrats have been members there. Cabinet officials, directors, and CEOs of large corporations, including major financial institutions, also attend. Major military contractors, oil companies, banks, including the Federal Reserve, utilities, including nuclear power, and national media have high-ranking officials as club members. The Grove appears to act as an informal doorway to the world of the elite. It's like the equivalent of the outermost circle of a satanic cult or the lowest levels of Freemasonry. People who attend are invited to bring guests with them each year. These guests are then sifted to find the ones who are most potentially useful for their aims. Doors are then opened to the inner circles for these people, and they are fast-tracked in their professions, whether it be politics, business, or the media. Along with the fast-tracking comes the promise of huge wealth. The newcomers are puffed up with pride, and appeals are made to their egotism and selfishness. They are told they are special and have unique gifts and talents. The exclusivity of the event is highlighted, and they are made to feel a sense of belonging. This is all designed to transfer their loyalties away from mankind in general, the masses, towards the establishment or the elite. On the first Saturday of the camp, the attendees perform a druid pagan ritual called the Cremation of Care. It begins with a procession of men in red robes and pointed hoods, some playing a funeral dirge and others carrying flaming torches. Transcripts from these rituals have been obtained and include specific references to Babylon and goodly Tyre. Remembering the Prince of Tyre, King of Tyre connection, we know that esoterically this refers to Satan. The Cremation of Care ceremony has the usual light meaning and dark meaning. The light meaning is that they are casting off their cares and worries so that they can enjoy their holiday. The real dark meaning is that the word care is another word for conscience. Therefore, the ritual represents a cremation or killing of the conscience, which will allow them to plot and partake in evil deeds. Remember how the Jesuits had to play mind tricks on themselves to try and overcome or bypass their conscience? It appears these Masons have a similar problem, and this ritual is a concerted effort to get rid of it. It all takes place in front of this giant owl.
Which would pursue us here has lost its power under these friendly trees. So shall we burn thee once again this night, and in the flames that eat thine effigy, we shall read the sign, Midsummer sets us free.
You shall burn me once again! Not with me, flame, which hither ye have brought from regions where I reign. Ye fools and priests, I spit upon your fire.
love, prince of all mortal wisdom. Owl of Bohemia, we beseech thee, grant us thy counsel. For great owl of Bohemia, we thank thee for thy adjuration.
Scary stuff, right? But this is what the elite call a good time on their holidays. Now, most accounts suggest that this owl is the form of Baal called Molech. He is mentioned in the Bible as one who demands child sacrifice and fire. However, the owl imagery aligns it more with Lilith, Athena or Asherah, the goddess in other words. I could be wrong, but it seems more likely that this is an idol for her. Ultimately, it doesn't really matter, as both are just facets of Satan. But given what we know about Lilith, it's also interesting that cross-dressing is apparently prevalent at the Grove, as it is with many occult societies that honour her. The Nebraska-based Knights of Aksar Ben are reported to participate in a festivity called Hijinks in Hades involving cross-dressing. A similarly named activity goes on at Bohemian Grove, where it is reported that the men and boys parade in women's clothing or dress up as Egyptian goddesses. Gender ambiguity in the ancient Mediterranean world was prevalent wherever the goddess Ishtar or Asherah was worshipped. Indeed, they had cult festivals specifically characterized by cross-dressing. There was one thing I didn't mention about the $1 bill before. It's an owl that sits in the top right-hand corner seen in this photo. Interestingly, some see a spider in this image instead of an owl. Personally, I believe it's an owl, but it's interesting that this sign exists at the entrance to Bohemian Grove. It reads, "Weaving spiders come not here," and so we have a sign here that combines both the owl and the spider. Manly P. Hall confirms and elaborates on what the evidence seems to support. Not only were many of the founders of the United States government Masons, but they received aid from a secret and august body existing in Europe, which helped them to establish this country for a peculiar and particular purpose, known only to the initiated few. Before we finish off this third section covering the Enlightenment era and move on to the present day, we need to explore more about this European secret body who were aiding the establishment of a Masonic America.